put off by how long this video is. Don't worry, I try to jam-pack my videos with as much content and as much detail as I possibly can. Anything I feel I can comment on and that I feel you might be interested in, I pretty much put in the video. I try not to repeat myself and talk fairly fast. I either have or will cover other parts of this franchise, and this video either is or will be linked below. I'm not going to restate here what I did or will say in the other video. These videos get long enough as it is. I got this either as a present or I got it on discount, so I did not pay very much money for this and am thus not bitter on account of that. Amnesia, A Machine for Pigs, game review. Starting, of course, with the plot. It's around New Year's Eve, and the year is 1899, so tonight we are going to party like it is, and it is party time, chums. Waking up wasted after a night of hard partying, I'm kidding, with the new century right around the corner. As with every major time of change, end of an era, it comes with fears of the end of the world, and even more so with it being a 99. Yeah. This is, you know, a century before Y2K. Wealthy English industrialist Oswald Mandus wakes in his bed and he has this horrible fever, and basically he hears his sons and is scared that they're in danger, and he realizes that he's the only one who can save them, which, you know, making the game about saving children, especially your own children, and they're like 8 or 10 years old, so they really do need to be protected. You know, that's obviously more altruistic than it being about yourself. And I'm not saying that that's a bad element of The Dark Descent, because The Dark Descent does explore, you know, that Daniel is fighting for his own survival. And you come to realize that there's a saboteur who's trying to make the path hard for you. What you have to do is go activate a machine, the actual machine for pigs, that in order to save your children, and you gradually come to realize more and more about the machine and what it does. I'm going to read a little from the narration, the opening text and or narration of the games made on this engine or earlier versions of this ending. I'm not going to read the entire thing of any of them, but just to give you an idea of whether or not these kind of pull you in, give you a real reason to be really invested, or if not so. Penumbra Overture. There are things I need of you. Things you may not understand, may not wish to do, but please do not make the same mistake I did. Yada, yada, yada. My name is Philip. If we are lucky, then by the time you receive this, I will be dead. If fate frowns, we all perish. The dark descent of the... I'm not going to read... Penumbra Requiem doesn't have one, and Penumbra Black Plague is just restating what has happened in the... Yeah, so it doesn't quite apply to the rest of these. Now, Amnesia the Dark Descent. I wish I could ask you how much you remember. I don't know if there will be anything left after I consume this drink. Don't be afraid, Daniel. And skipping ahead a little. Yeah, you know, hopefully the name Alexander of Brandenburg still invokes bitter anger in you. If not, this will sound horrible. Go find Alexander and kill him. And, yeah, you know, descend into the darkness where Alexander waits and murder him. Your former self, Daniel. See, that, okay, I understand what's going on. This intrigues me. I don't know if I want to go kill a guy that I don't even know anything about, but I want to see where this goes. And a machine for pigs. In my dreams, I see a man dressed in jaguar skins and feathered like a bloody saint. The fetid... Yeah, I think that's how I pronounce it. Heat of the jungle mirrored somewhere behind my forehead. Even the laudanum will not quell endless hunger. I hear my children playing in the attic, but it fills me with terror, not love. What desperate thoughts are these? So, yeah. That's... a slight step backwards in that regard here. Now, moving on to on plot. As I've already somewhat stated, I am going to be talking about the games made by Frictional Games, and when doing so, I will be calling them Frictional Games, rather than the repetitive Frictional Games games. I have not played Soma at all yet, so... Yeah, when I say Frictional Games, I mean the rest of them. I mean every game leading up to this one. And I do own it, and I will get to it. Now, I don't need this game to be, you know, going into this, I did not need this game to be like The Dark Descent or any of Frictional's games or any other game I know to enjoy it. I have now played the three Penumbra games 4 times each and The Dark Descent 5 times, including during this, even though I had completed it between the 23rd of 10th and the 25th of 10th, and I completed both The Dark Descent a final time yesterday and Machine for Pigs the first time today, so yeah. I liked a lot about this. Compared to Frictional's games, it's better in some ways, worse in others. Overall, I do prefer Frictional's games, and ultimately, The Dark Descent is more scary, intense, and tense than this. Now, as others have noted, Frictional Games learned a lot making the three Penumbra games, and each has them apply things they learned from the previous one, and they applied what they had learned to The Dark Descent. And the Chinese room who developed this did not have this experience, and this, I believe, is the first... This is only, like, their second game, and it's the first time they've done enemies at all, and it does show. I'll get more into that. Now, I will say I've been, you know, in playing this, I was interested in what's going on, the story, the world, right from the start, and that hasn't really waned. Though I will admit there were a number of things that I had trouble understanding and following. And I will be saying that's the same as in Dark Descent or variations thereof a number of times in this. I don't mean that and about, like, relative weaknesses and such. I don't mean that makes it okay. I mean that you shouldn't judge this harsher than you did that, unless something else makes the element worse here. Now, some have pointed out that his amnesia is different from Daniel's. Daniel consumed a drink that erased his memories, full well knowing that this was what it was going to, you know. And that's not a spoiler, hence the note that I read a little from. He chose to erase his own memory, and over the course of the game you find out why that is. In this, Mandus did not choose to have amnesia, and his amnesia is not caused directly by some kind of physical event. He didn't get hit on the head either. And this is, again, not a spoiler. It's because of this fever that, you know, he returned from Mexico, and so, yeah, he had some kind of, you know, today, okay, well, he has some sort of exotic flu. We have, you know, he would probably get a shot for that before even going there. Back then, not so much. So, yeah, he's racked with fever, and I'm not going to give away the exact circumstances that, you know, there are more details to it than that, but yes, the reason he has amnesia is because he is sick. He has a really high fever. And we find this out very early on. And I will say that I wasn't always entirely clear on how much Manders did remember, where, again, with Daniel, okay, he's basically forgotten everything. That's what it does, you know. He's losing his memory, and you hear him say, okay, I remember my name, I remember where I live, and that's basically, you know, he remembers almost nothing at all. And that's the way the player enters the game, because we're not told up front what's going on. We just find out, you know, before he erased his memory, Daniel wanted to kill Alexander. We know that he's in Brennenburg Castle, Alexander's castle, and we're told about the shadow. There are a few details, but basically you don't know very much. And most of what you do know, that's because Daniel wrote it down before he took away his memory. In this, you know, I mean, when you, yeah, you have that thing of, you know, I wake in my bed and I'm racked with fever and I hear my children. So, okay, he knows that, you know, like if you wake up with complete amnesia, you wouldn't be like, oh, those are my children. You'd be like, children, I wonder whose they are, you know. So he certainly does remember some things. And I do think that the game could have done a little bit better of a job of clarifying if the things that I was learning from notes and such, if Mandus had also, like, repressed those or such. And they do. Mandus speaks sometimes in this, which is unusual for one of these games. I'm not going to give away exactly how unusual, but he actually does. And given that, I think that they could maybe have had him just, like, give vague indications of, like, you know, yeah, if someone else reminds you of something you've forgotten for a while, you'll be like, oh, right, or something like that. If just every so often when you're finding something out that Mandus knew but had repressed, it would be, you know, something like that, and maybe not really have anything when it's something that he maybe even hadn't forgotten at all or something, but yeah. And yeah, you are an industrialist and a butcher, so yeah, the machine is literally for pigs, and it's huge. It's incredibly imposing. It will take you a very long time to move all the way through the machine or around it. You're not always within the machine, and certainly you don't start within the machine, but, and along the way you'll sometimes see this diagram of the whole thing, and it'll be this highlighted, you know, the section that you're in will be highlighted, and that helps you appreciate the scope. Now, some have said that the story is bloated and, you know, which would basically be defined as the writer tries to give the reader every single detail, whether it's needed or not. And, yeah, that is kind of true. And by contrast, Frictional's games, it will every so often move on to something new. You know, it'll introduce and or explore a new setting, new incident, new location. You know, when you're playing through Overture, yeah, it's similar things have happened to different people, and, you know, there are everyone who tried to have, like, a base of operations or a mining station or something in this area, something bad eventually happened, and they point in similar directions and such. But at the end of the day, after a little while, you're no longer in the World War II outpost. You're no longer in the mining area. You know, you gradually move through these areas, and the people you read about are different people. They're not, it's not constantly the same, where, you know, yeah, in this, it's almost all about, like, Mandus himself, the machine, and sort of the, you know, his immediate, you know, interpersonal relationships and such. And some have said that the story is too simple, and the story of the Dark Descent is also quite simple. You know, go kill Alexander and hurry so you don't die because of the shadow. And the shadow is really, you know, you could remove the shadow's presence from the plot and not lose all that much, ultimately. Especially, it's basically there to hurry the player along. It's a ticking clock. But yeah, you know, what the Dark Descent does tell its backstory more gradually, making it feel more like you're understanding what's going on, what has happened, and it does better world building. And in this, yeah, it's the machine, the failed expedition, Mandus' personal relationship, not really the city, people Mandus worked with, and such. You do find out some things about that, but it doesn't spend very much on that. Now, some have noted this doesn't have any alternate endings. It really doesn't lend itself to them, and that's, you know, I like both versions. I like that the Dark Descent does have alternate endings, and I like that this doesn't, because in both cases it works. And I mean, it's hardly much of a criticism of this, unless you really need your games to have alternate endings. It's not a very big element of the Dark Descent, and you can get all three. I guess it's not a huge spoiler that there are three. You can get all of them on the first playthrough, and it's really not that difficult to get the hardest earned one. You know, I mean, we're not talking like Jedi Knight or, you know, Jedi Academy also does kind of serve you. But yeah, you know, Star Wars Dark Forces 2, Jedi Knight, you have to play through the entire game a second time if you want the other of the two endings, you know, the dark side or light side ending. And they actually feel fairly different. So, yeah, you can really tell, okay, I was the good guy. Okay, I was definitely the bad guy. Now, the ending really lacks the level of detail that the Dark Descent's ending has. You know, both are huge in scope, visually memorable, they're a grand event, you face the villain, but yeah, it's not as big, and the opening also just does not use the abilities of the game engine anywhere near as much as that of The Dark Descent. Now, some don't like the ending. I understand, but I do think it definitely fits the rest of the game. And I feel like it's supposed to have a fairly strong impact, and somewhat like when finishing Minerva's Den, you know, the BioShock 2 DLC, it didn't have that much of an impact on me, but I did like it fine, and it makes sense. It's not some kind of like sudden, well, how does that work? It makes sense, and it fits thematically. You could argue that it's not necessarily that much of a twist. You could see it coming, but I do think that this doesn't go so much for the twists as much as it goes for thematically, like, it's foreshadowing. It's telling you down the line this is probably what's going to happen, and that has this kind of... It's like when you... Maybe somewhat the first time you catch one of Shakespeare's tragedies, and especially when you're returning to it later and you know where it's going to go, you're seeing the steps that lead there, and it's and you're powerless to do anything about it. And you know, sometimes that is how big tragedies happen in life as well. The signs were there, but we ignored them. And I do think that it does a quite good job with that. This is not to excuse bad twists and obvious twists that aren't built too very well. Those are a problem in some fiction, but just I don't think that's the case here. Now, the opening, some have really hated, and there's this... Basically, you're seeing the machine come on, and it's very ominous, but it has this kind of electricity to it, and it looks really bad, and it's the kind of thing where, you know, you don't want to put on display like that effects that just aren't that good, and they aren't that, you know, the electricity in The Dark Descent, it looks a little better than it does here, but it's still not amazing, but they were better at hiding it. And you see the machine in your dream, basically. Or at least that's one take on it, that's what's happening. And basically everything you see, you do see through Mandus's eyes. There's nothing... Yeah. And all cutscenes are in-engine, like with The Dark Descent. It's all first-person perspective, POV. And it's a good title. It's much more distinct than the Penumbra games have these really pretentious titles, and they're also not that, you know, you could put like these kinds of titles on, you know. Yeah, pick a horror movie that, you know, if it had been like Children of the Corn that Kierman had relatively recently reviewed, you know, if it had been like Children of the Corn 2, Overture, Children of the Corn 5, Black Plague, you know, Requiem, that would have worked fine, The Dark Descent, but, you know, here it actually, a machine for pigs, that's not something you've really heard before, and it works. I mean, I'm not saying that there's a reason for each subtitle of the Frictional games, but there, you know, yeah, it is a Dark Descent, but ultimately, it's like... Video game developers really need to retire calling their game something with dark in it. You know, you've got the Star Wars, you know, what was it, Dark Forces. You've got Thief of the Dark Project, Amnesia of the Dark Descent. It just, in each of those cases, it makes sense, but it's just, it you know, it's almost like you need a thesaurus. Okay, it's dark. You wanna say that it's dark. Don't just say that it's dark, you know. But yeah, it's also pretty evocative, a machine for pigs, and obviously it has more than one meaning, and you'll, you know, go through those. Now, I have not played anything else by the Chinese Room. I don't currently plan to. I played this because of its connection to Frictional's games, and I enjoyed it, but I'm not sure that I... There are definitely things in this that I understand is in Dear Esther as well, or in... Anyway. And I wouldn't mind seeing those again, but I just... At the end of the day, I haven't really... Frictional are really the only ones that make me interested in new, like, first-person perspective, adventure, puzzle gaming, you know. Other than that, I love that you can't really do much to fight enemies in these games, but if I'm gonna be running around in an action-adventure game, I mostly want to be able to fight. You know, I just completed Beyond Good and Evil again, and I'm completing Psychonauts again, and just, yeah, you know, You have to really give me something amazing if you're not going to let me fight enemies. Now, some say that, you know, the story focuses so heavily on the pig metaphor that, you know, you'll grow tired of hearing, you know, the word or synonyms for pig, and... Yeah, I can see that. And someone noted that the game manages to explain over and over at you constantly and somehow tell you almost nothing about the story. And yeah, that I do think that's really unfortunate. Now, this does have a, you know, it's not too little and vague of a connection to The Dark Descent like Justine. This is for sure a sequel, and it goes bigger, not necessarily better, on a number of its plot points, building on concepts introduced there. And it is even more of a Lovecraftian Cthulhu story than The Dark Descent. Now, moving on to plot details. Now, some said that they were, you know, they started out really trying to get into it, reading notes, listening for every sound, but as the story went on, the less they cared, and, you know, saying its characters were severely lacking, and on a whole, the game is uneventful, and I suppose you could say uneventful, but I didn't really stop caring at any point. Honestly, I think I might in some ways have come to care more the further along it, you know, I got, and the more that it, the more I realized about the world. Now, the notes sometimes explain in a really detached tone something that horrifies us, such as how the machine handles the pigs and such. And this is, again, you know, that's something both of these Amnesia games do. You're getting information that you the player already know that this information led to the protagonist losing his memory and, you know, coming to and, you know, having sort of a mission. Although in The Dark Descent, that mission is thrust upon you, not something not something you reach on your own. And so as you read these things, you know it's going to lead to this thing, and thus it makes you, in The Dark Descent, it's maybe especially when you're reading, you know, this kind of adventurous stuff, and Daniel is excited and really intrigued by this or that thing, and he's trying to investigate something, and we know where his investigation will lead. In this, it's that the machine, when it was being developed, you know, Mandus was in a different state of mind, as it were, and yeah, it has a really compelling effect. I'll get more into that. And it has been noted that there are less notes to pick up, and they get too long, and some of them are useless. That is unfortunately very much the case. And none of the notes you find are voiced, which just, it harms the immersion. And, you know, it's not every single one that you found in The Dark Descent was voiced, but they kind of tried to do it for most of them, and it really helps a lot to just, yeah. And some have said that the notes written by the children, you know, they read like they were written by 20-something Victorian gentlemen, and honestly, I feel like they fit the children of the time of this kind of upper class. You know, he's wealthy, so they're gonna get a big education and such. And I'm not saying that the kids necessarily think like this. If we were hearing their thoughts, they wouldn't be as organized and as well put as this. But, you know, there are things that the children wrote down that they, like, thought of or found interesting or things like that. And I would say it fits, that it's well educated and something. And, you know, part of the point of having creepy children is, of course, that you're getting this kind of perspective, the childlike perspective and such. And I would say that it does maintain that. You know, the children are like, you know, oh, we wanted to play in that room, but then we were told not to. We know it's not because of that. I wonder what's in there. We keep hearing weird noises from in there. And yeah, it works. And some have said that, at least one reviewer said that the notes had an unreadable font. And it's true that it's a little, you know, you have to get a little used to it, but unreadable, I have to imagine that he's playing on a very low resolution, or that, I don't know, yeah, something like that, or maybe like ESL or something, which, you know, that's fine, I'm not insulting the guy, or I don't mean to be, but yeah, I completely disagree with that. Resolution maybe graphics level. I found one note that had a swear, and it's the S word, and it's used in reference to defecation. I don't know. I wish they had used another a non-swear word of it. It doesn't fit. And I'm not a prude or something. You can swear as much as you like. It's just it doesn't fit here. Now, notes can become overly descriptive or elaborate, and yeah, that's definitely very much the case and very much a problem. I feel like I think the writer who wrote the story and these notes probably I don't know if they have or will or whatever, but it's like someone who might write a full-on novel. And I get that it's difficult to go from writing novels and such to writing stuff like this, but The Dark Descent does manage to, if you read Remember, which comes with at least some, simply purchased versions of The Dark Descent, Mikael Hedberg, I want to say it is, who wrote the game and wrote this series of short stories, clearly does, he can do both very well. It doesn't, in neither of them does it feel like it's the other one. You never find a note that feels like it's part of a novel, and you never encounter a part in one of the short stories that feels like it should have, been in a game where you can pick up a note and then you keep walking a little bit after. And some said that the writing was better in the writing shined in the notes in comparison to the formal game, but failed to add up to anything meaningful. I disagree. I would definitely on the meaningful part, I would definitely say it does. It's a putrid, vile story, and this kind of philosophical story with references that make you think. And on that, I definitely do want to say, you can dislike this without being stupid, and you can like it without being smart. There are references and such that you will appreciate more if you know a lot about, like, there are a bunch of mythological ones, for example, and yeah, obviously they will do more, but just because you get those doesn't mean that it's, or just because you don't get, yeah. And the story has you twisting between empathy and loathing, and that really is, yeah, as one reviewer put it, and that really, that nails it. It's you just, and it's really, that's not easy to do, and we are talking full on empathy, full on loathing. We're not talking like, oh well, okay, I guess I can, no, full on, you are going back and forth between these two extremes, and it's, you can understand why Mandus himself is so, I suppose the word is, it's like a war within him that has waged over time, that you can see that some of these decisions were clearly made by someone deeply ill in and at the same time you can sometimes really understand why he did what he did, the lesser of two evils, driven to do awful things many times, and these themes are in The Dark Descent as well. And like with the other themes that it goes into, that the Dark Descent goes into, in here, it's more about others, not saving yourself. And yeah, the chases are intense and far between, leaving you on the edge of your seat. Right when you let your guard down, you're being chased down an alleyway. And yes, as some have noted, it's not the world that you're moving through is not necessarily the scariest, but if you read very carefully and you, like, you know, your mind imagines the things you read, then you're really going to start being very scared. And that is one thing. Could this have been a novel? Yes. I don't think it should have been. I think it would have helped a lot if they had, like, a strict editor working on the, you know, looking over every note written and spread out some, you know, I'm not saying that there's much information in there that we shouldn't get. I'm saying they should have been spread out so that instead of sitting still for a minute reading one note, over, you know, you get two notes and you sit still for 30 seconds, then read one, then, you know, a minute later you find another note that says, yeah. Because ultimately this is very much about the world, the physical world you're moving through, as well as what you're reading. Some say it has uneven pacing, a nonsensical story. I disagree with the second part, but yeah, the pacing, yeah. Flowery narrative. A lot of people say it's not scary. I don't know what they... Maybe they and I have different definitions of the word scary. I've played games that tried to be scary and weren't. I forget exactly what it's called, but there's a point-and-click first-person perspective adventure game where you're chasing Jack the Ripper, and it's like 100 years later or something, and it's in another big city or something, and you're a reporter, you want to try to take a picture of him, and you're trying to find out who he's gonna go after next and stop him if you can. You're like a newspaper, I forget if you're a writer or a photographer. I guess maybe a photographer. Anyway, I'm almost certain you're not a cop, because you gotta tell if you're a cop. But that game definitely wants to be scary, and it so isn't, and it's really unfortunate, because there's definite potential there for it to be scary, but I know scary when I see it, and I'm not going to say that this is, like I said, The Dark Descent is scarier, but this game is really scary. I guess if you turn down the volume real low and you don't play the whole thing, maybe you won't be scared. But if you play through the whole one, or maybe, I guess, if you sprint and you're not really slowing down to pay attention, which I will admit, there are games that you can sprint through and they'll still scare you. But yeah, if you're playing it, yeah. And, you know, Just to make sure that you don't think that I'm someone who's scared by just anything, I've been watching scary movies for almost 2 decades, since I was 13. I watched a few before that, as young as when I was 7, and I've watched basically everything I could get my hands off. John Carpenter, including The Thing and Halloween, and David Cronenberg, including Videodrome and The Fly. So, I know scary. Now, it does get bogged down in its themes at points. And it goes into how does society treat those who we view as second-class citizens? How do I treat them? And, of course, the themes of industrialism, sacrificing people's humanity, and for the regular people, you know, the workers, their well-being emotionally and in too many cases, even their physical well-being to where many were injured, even died, because the rich wanted them to work harder, as their machines could. And this is set before industrialism was tempered with caring about the workers. Or, you know, unions, which I know a lot of uninformed people hate. Now, yeah, as some note, the narrative, you know, it's nightmarish and the environments are oppressive. The themes nihilistic and monstrous, bleak and truly horrific. And the written exposition is bizarrely creative and unsettling. And the survival aspects of the game take a dive. Yeah, the narrative intention in Strangers ratchets up in the last third, but the survival aspects of the game take a dive simultaneously towards the game's climax. And there is maybe too much wandering around admiring the scenery and not enough stuff to do or scares to go around. And some say it should have been a movie instead of a game. I could more see that, but... And... Yeah, and the soul of Amnesia is maintained. It's a game that understands that real horror comes from disempowerment, from the unseen, unknown, and unexplained. And apparently some of the elements of the gameplay that were removed were because the Chinese room aren't good at working with those elements. And, you know, that's fair enough. Nobody's good at everything. But I'm not saying this has genuinely bad gameplay, but genuinely bad gameplay is one of the worst problems any game can have. If your game doesn't really have gameplay or it's very limited, it's casual, a walking simulator or the like. I'm personally not interested in those, and I really don't want to buy one by accident. And ultimately, this one does come very close to being, you know, just a walking simulator. Just, yeah, it's not quite there, but... And it does have, you know, the gameplay is... To an extent, just walking simulator. Now, yeah, the Chinese room created a unique world that mirrors the mind of the protagonist. And it's a game that gets you thinking. Now, some said that the protagonist is unlikable. I really don't agree. There are certainly times where he is, but not as a whole. And some say that it's the exposition is this weird pseudo-poetic exposition, and I'm not sure that's necessarily a bad way to put it. And, you know, some said that this, you know, the Chinese room think that it makes the plot nuanced and complex, but instead it just makes it harder to identify with the protagonist. And that's a lot like, you know, Overture and Black Plague. And, yeah, that really is unfortunate. And even the objective notes are like this, you know. He writes entire sentences about how he feels or his current situation. That's fine, but don't put the objective in the middle of that. Put it separately. And the twist ending is quite predictable, but again, that I feel that it builds to it nicely. But yeah, you know, an objective is something that you should be able to read. An objective description is something that you should be able to read 100 times and just immediately figure out what you're supposed to do from that. I mean, it helps that a lot of the objectives are easy in this, but at the end of the day, you know, you will be going for minutes, you know, for a while in this with the same one objective, and if strange things happen along the way, you might have to remind yourself, you know, something happened that you didn't expect at all, and you have to really remind yourself, wait, what exactly am I here to do? Because, yeah, you know, that's the whole point of writing them down. Otherwise, it could just tell you once. You know, the scares don't repeat, for example. I know this isn't a big deal, but when you've read an objective, you have to click the whole way out of it. You can't click it away with a single click of the left mouse button. You have to click 3 times. That's really annoying. It should be just 1, as it is with the notes. New notes, at least. I think if you go back and reread, it's, yeah. The ending is thought-provoking. I do think that there are things about the ending that, yeah, it did leave me wondering, what about this thing that was still, yeah. And some have said it tells too much of the plot too early, which is like Overture and thus also Black Plague. And some have said that the predictable plot twist was supposed to be dramatic irony, and they say it could have worked out better. I suppose so, maybe, yeah. And it's been pointed out, you know, this was marketed as an Amnesia game, sold as one, and, you know, then, yeah, it wasn't supposed to be one, but, yeah, it shouldn't have been marketed and sold as one then. And, you know, I found that I cared about the plot and characters more than in Overture and Black Plague. Not necessarily quite as much as in The Dark Descent. And the, you know, the core setup is fairly easy to get into. I suppose I should call this section the Frictional games. Yeah, Frictional got better and better at a number of things, and this is me listing them and then comparing to A Machine for Pigs. Is the core setup easy to get into? You know, the protagonist is curious, making obvious mistakes, where he goes and how prepared he is, You're almost frustrated with Philip for what he does, whereas in The Dark Descent, you know, curiosity led you to being cursed to die soon. You go for one last chance to make it, and it doesn't turn out the way you had hoped, you know. And yeah, in I'm not going to give away exactly what Mandus wanted to do or how he tried to do it, but you can understand where he was coming from. What he was working against is something you would work against, and the, you know, what he did makes sense if you're, you know, fever ridden and you're like just if what you yeah, you know, it you can understand from where he was what he did. You know, and another thing that they got better at, you know, whether what has happened to you, what has happened that you learn of feels distant from you or close to you, you know, did something similar happen to you, and or is it universally relatable, whether or not there's too much reading material and there isn't this. And like I said, you know, almost everything that we're told in this, Mandus had a direct hand in, or experienced firsthand. You know, and they got better at not having so many people writing in great detail about their imminent death. You know, a few make sense, that's fine, but so many, and that, yeah, here there are some where it's like written from other people, and they're talking about how bad their situation is, but it makes sense. They're trying to make sense of the madness around them rather than just sitting and waiting for their own death and, yeah, thinking of, you know, you, okay, maybe you're focused on it. Why are you writing it down? And, you know, yeah, whether or not it's overwritten, words chosen, how vague it is it all in past tense, especially by the protagonist? Again, A Machine for Pigs doesn't do well at that. Whether there are a lot of different people and you're piecing it all together, or just a few authors and it's easier to follow, this does pretty good at that. A little or a lot voice acting, and then this... There's more voice acting than you might think. It's just that not a lot of it is in the notes, but a lot of things are said. There are far more words you read in notes than are voiced, but there's still... And, you know, whether you're rereading a diary that your memories of have been erased by yourself, and are there too many memories, sometimes several close, too close to each other? Which, this, you know, yeah, that is the case here. You know, is there one source of excessive exposition and other info in spite of otherwise doing well? Not the case here. You know, whether storytelling happens and hints delivered via this half-life style in-engine, memories recalled, and, you know, whether you can, you know, right-click on everything, get a Silent Hill-y text description, or if you gain it from looking at it, and maybe it's in loading screens between rooms. And this one does not have anywhere near as many loading screens as The Dark Descent, and they're vague, but they are telling you things. And, you know, whether or not loading screens have these past events described that mirror current ones, and that's Yeah, in this, it's always relating to what is going on, but it's not the I suppose it's not something. Yeah, I'm not sure how to put that. Whether animal life or anything living is, you know, always means they're out to hurt you, or small animals might be there for atmosphere, like rats or bugs. In this, there's no animal life other than, yeah. Whether or not you need your own light a lot, if it's in some areas that still dark with it, and or the close to wall and or hidden blue light. And in this, I'll get more into the light. Whether it does or doesn't let you light static light sources, but you have a limited amount of the tinderbox to light them. Which, you know, really makes you wonder, am I going to spend enough time in this area to warrant lighting, and might the game blow out one or more static light sources? Whether the person... Let's see... Whether there is or isn't more than one difficulty setting. And save checkpoints give backstory in addition to, or merely give more details on something that I'm going to explore here. Whether dying means you respawn at most recent save, or it might despawn nearby enemies and leave you with any items you have picked up since saving. In this one, I'm almost certain this one basically only saves either when you tell it exit and save, or when you've just entered a new area. And that doesn't mean that you have to replay a bunch if you die or such, but you know, basically, it does the same as The Dark Descent. You respawn nearby, yeah, not really having lost anything, and the monster might even be gone. And whether or not it's entirely or not quite clear when it saves, whether you autosave or checkpoint save or can save an exit, which is somewhat like quick saving. Reading an inventory interaction doesn't or does pause the game. I really love that about the Penumbra games. I just wish they made it clearer from earlier on, because each time I forget. And the first few times, you know, I'm like, wait, it sounds like something moving, but it isn't, is it? And then eventually I'm reading something and an enemy comes up behind and attacks me, even though I was reading and I thought that it was maybe paused. I just wish that, you know, one of the first times you read something, maybe it would make sure to have like some water that was running next to the player while you read, so that you can tell, okay, it's not actually paused. I almost wish that these didn't pause, you know, the two Amnesia games. Whether it doesn't or does have a user profile system, whether or not you keep having to let yourself fall down an opening that you clearly shouldn't have been able to survive, something you note both before and after the drop, and that does happen in this a few times. And, you know, detailed creepy descriptions when you examine things, whether or not it plays on a lot or just a few fears. I maintain there are characters that they should never have shown in a third-person perspective in Penumbra. And we do yet again get another hugely different enemy motivation and personality. You know, the ones in Black Plague and The Dark Descent have very few things in common. and whether or not it's a hugely obvious twist where the solution is given very early on, we just get more details as we go. Is it an Overture and Black Plague? Not really the Dark Descent. And, you know, whether or not it's a huge step up from the previous ones. You know, I just replayed all of the games, all of Frictional's games, and I had completely forgotten how huge of a leap it really is between the two, the HPL engine versions that they use. It really, right off the bat, in, like, you know, one of the first things you see in Amnesia, in The Dark Descent, is so much more, like, detailed and, you know, a compelling, you know, than anything you ever see in the, you know, and that's, yeah, that's plain and simple, the, you know, how much money and how much time they had to make them. And whether or not, you know, I mean, the Penumbra games were made on the first version of this engine, so, you know, they it wasn't an upgrade to another engine. And yeah, you know, and you know, far greater physics, way scarier, more intense. Honestly, in a lot of ways, I do prefer Overture and Black Plague. You know, bigger and prettier doesn't always mean better. Honestly, of Frictional's games, I think I like each at least a little less than the one before, even though they largely get better with each. And, you know, in Black Plague, the physics engine allows turning on angles somewhat, and it can be frustrating still. And in The Dark Descent, you don't need to use it as much. And I would prefer they improved how you did it, like by the X, Y, and Z axes instead. In this, you no longer have, you know, really long arms or super strength. It does take a little getting used to. You have to get really close. You have to pull harder with the mouse, and when you play this, make sure that you very early on note, okay, I have to be this close, I have to pull this hard, because otherwise you might almost miss things where you're like, well, I mean, I feel like I should be able to go through here, but I can't reach the door. Go all the way up to it, you know, and I mean, I'm trying to open it, it won't quite open. Keep pulling, pull harder, pull for longer. You know, there are, of course, times where you legitimately can't do the thing, but, yeah. And I've already gone into some of the missteps. I don't think there were any ideas in this that weren't fully thought through, and there are at least a few in Overture, Black Plague, Requiem, and The Dark Descent. You know, adjustments that ended up hurting the game. You know, that's especially the case in The Dark Descent. I'm not sure there really was any of that here. It doesn't feel like it was, there was like late adjustments that, yeah. On Metacritic, user reviews for this one, A Machine for Pigs, I noticed that a lot of these negative reviews, the person signed up on the site specifically to rate and review this game and hasn't really done any others, and that tells you something about how disappointed these people were. And I'm not going to say that, oh, well, you know, look, they didn't even bother to do other, if a piece of creative expression makes you go out of your way to, you know, discuss it, you know, you must have either really liked it or really disliked it. And I don't think signing up for something like that means you have to start reviewing everything that you watch or play. And, you know, The Dark Descent was set in 1839, while this is set in 1899. And, you know, same universe, but new cast of characters, new time setting. Now, as a sequel, I'm not sure that this should have had the Amnesia title on it. You know, a lot, although far from all, critics felt misled by that, and I do think that that's fair enough. I feel like they should maybe have... I'm not sure this even really should have been on the same engine as The Dark Descent. If, like, just Frictional had come out and said, hey, we think you should check this game out, but it was made on a different engine and it wasn't called Amnesia, I do think that that would have helped it. And, you know, maybe you would just be, oh, hey, it's in some ways reminiscent of Amnesia, but there are probably too many things very, you know, that Amnesia, the Dark Descent have that make you think, okay, a game that's called Amnesia is going to have these same things that just aren't here. You know, that's, yeah. But, you know, others have said, you know, well, maybe there'll be like an anthology and each will be different. And, you know, if they do make a third one or more, and I do think that that could be interesting, especially, you know, hopefully people would know by, you know, with the third one, okay, it's not going to be like the first two, it's just, it is definitely the same universe. If you go into this and you're like, I want to know what happened after The Dark Descent, that, yeah, that had some relation to that. I mean, at the end of The Dark Descent, Daniel's story is, you don't necessarily need a lot more there. You know, this story is, you know, and that's also the thing, you can play the first one, never play this, and feel satisfied with that as well. And that I do think is, that can be a really good way to do sequels. But, you know, yeah, if there are more, you know, maybe this will be like the season of the witch of the series. They made a lot of changes to, you know, the Amnesia as it was by in The Dark Descent. And one of the reasons is to provide a fresh gameplay experience to veteran players of The Dark Descent. But I, you know, and I think, as some have noted, it's not necessarily the fact that they're taking things away, which they are, from The Dark Descent. It's that they don't really replace them with anything. What we have in this game is what's left, what they didn't take out. You know, they don't really change anything other than taking things away, and other things they just do, you know, the notes and physical interaction, you know, the way that, you know, yeah, you pick up notes and then they get put up on the screen, then you read them, then you click on. That works the exact same as in Frictional games. And Now, you know, there might also be some streamlining for greater mainstream appeal, though I do think that I don't think this is more, you know, what you have in The Dark Descent is so intuitive that they didn't need to really change anything about that to make it, yeah. And I don't think this does go, you know, more intuitive, for example. And, you know, when, yeah, the decisions behind the changes still largely don't make sense. It's hard to tell why they thought it would be a good approach. It feels more like that thing of, you know, well, they didn't really know how to do this or that well. And, yeah, in that case, they should have just said, we're not going to be, you know, and apparently this did start as a custom story, but then they made it bigger and bigger. And I can appreciate that, but somewhere along the way they should have said, you know what, this engine probably isn't the right. This game would not be much different or much lesser without, say, the physics. If it was just, you know, the old-fashioned point and click of you just when you would have otherwise pulled or pushed or pulled something in this, you just click it and it gives you options for what to do, it would have been to an extent the same game. And you know, it is really, you know, it was meant for Halloween 2012 and then it was delayed, and it doesn't feel like the delay really, it doesn't feel like the quality of the final game means that it needed to be delayed. And yeah, it's a fresh and new approach to the Amnesia world while staying true to its origins. That I would largely agree with. And you know, released in spite of negatives, and they said they were proud of it, like with Requiem. Now, moving on to the length. Some have said that this took them an hour and a half to complete. I guess if you sprint through the whole thing and just, yeah. You know, you can run through any game, and if you're not taking your time taking it in, you're doing it wrong. You're doing yourself and the game a disservice, and that's true of any game like this that you choose to just run through. Now, The Dark's Descent took me 12 hours, you know, on the different playthroughs, 12 hours, then 6, you know, now around 4. You know, 3 if I'm just listening through the commentary and obviously sprinting. This took me 4.5 hours to complete. So, you know, if I, walking through The Dark Descent the first time, if I had known, you know, basically where, more or less where things were, it would have taken me the same amount of time as this. Now, I could have sprinted through it for faster or walked slower. This was the speed that came naturally to me. I tried to take it all in and carefully read every note, examine every area. There wasn't a point in this game where I was like, I'm just going to run through this. I basically didn't run unless I felt like I absolutely had to. Now, I'm not, it maybe doesn't have that much replayability. You know, the Overture doesn't have collectibles, but Black Plague, well, yeah, and The Dark Descent don't have collectibles. Black Plague and Requiem do. This one doesn't really have them, and I do think that it could have been, it could have worked. You know, the ones in Black Plague and Requiem, you could also just easily remove if you wanted to, but they are there, and that does mean that there's replayability there, you know. I don't know yet if Soma has any collectibles. Now, The Dark Descent, A Machine for Pigs, and Soma have achievements, but the ones for, you know, I've just played A Machine for Pigs and just replayed The Dark Descent. I didn't unlock any, you know, achievements, and apparently they aren't quite, they just don't quite work yet. And, you know, all of these achievements are hidden, which is exactly as it should be for a horror game. Now, for replay value, you know, The Dark Descent doesn't really have any, you know, in this there aren't difficulty settings the way there are in Overture and Black Plague. You know, there aren't, like in Black Plague and Requiem, a few on-off settings that can increase the challenge level and randomization. Now, when you're playing a puzzle game a second time, you enjoy putting in the work to pass the puzzle, not the figuring out of the puzzle. Even if you don't completely remember, you're going to be like, well, there's something with this. You know, on this, on replays, won't even have the aforementioned enjoyment because the puzzles are so simple. I'm going to get more into that, but, you know, and similar to those, the story will no longer be new to you, so it will be less enjoyable than proper puzzle games. It will just be, you know, the story and the atmosphere another time, to where some would say it should have been a novel or a movie. Now, as others note, it never really gets boring or frustrating. There are no passages in particular that qualifies anything less than enjoyable. Some have said that it oddly somehow manages to outstay its welcome in record time. And, yeah, it's the kind of thing, I'm not sure there are demos for this, but I would say you'll very early be able to tell if it's for you. And, you know, borrow a friend's copy or something, play the first half hour maybe. If by then, how you feel about the game is how you're going to keep feeling about, you know, whether or not you want to keep playing or it's not really for you. And yeah, considering its length, the delayed release does look kind of bad. Now, moving on to the characters. Actually, hold that thought.